ahead and open to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. And as you guys have been going through the Sermon on the Mount, we're going to pick it up right where we left off. A few weeks ago, you guys were there at the end of chapter 6. And so now we're going to go through the first six verses of chapter 7. So go ahead and turn to Matthew 7. If you're a note taker, you can write down the title of the study today, which is The Court of the King. The Court of the King. We're going to look at how we are to be judges in the King's court. And as we go through this today, just by way of reminder, we're talking about the way of the King with the Sermon on the Mount. And so I don't know if you guys do this in junior high, but in high school, we make you guys stand up and read. You guys stand up and read in junior high? Yeah? Good. So you're used to it. Go ahead and stand up, and we're going to read the word together there in Matthew chapter 7. So once you guys are standing, we'll start reading, and we'll go through this text today. All right. A couple more of you guys. Go ahead and stand up as we read. All right. So let's begin there at Matthew chapter 7, beginning in verse 1. He says, "Judge not, that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at a speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me remove the speck from your eye,' and look, a plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces." This is God's word. Let's pray together. Father, God, we're thankful that 2,000 years ago that Jesus got into a boat, pushed off from the shore a little bit. The people gathered around there on the shore, and he gave the most powerful, life-changing, life-challenging sermon that has ever been preached, even through the current day. And so, God, as we continue to make our way through this Sermon on the Mount, God, I trust that you're going to challenge each of us today. Lord, that you are going to challenge the believer to be more like you. God, you're going to challenge the non-believer that they need a Savior, which is you. And so, God, as we go through this text, as we go through these verses, I pray that you would be our teacher this morning, that you'd fill us with your Holy Spirit and with understanding, that we may walk in a way that's pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. As we go ahead and take your seats, as we continue our way through the Sermon on the Mount, we remember that the theme of Jesus' teaching is the way of the King. And as Pastor Tate has been teaching you guys through this sermon, he's been very clear that Jesus is teaching how things really work in God's kingdom, and also how the citizens of God's kingdom, that's you and I who are Christians here today, are supposed to behave. How are we supposed to behave in light of the brand new life Jesus has given us? Well, that's what the Sermon on the Mount is all about. If you are a child of God today, if you've been born again, you've given your life to Christ, then this sermon, as in the Sermon on the Mount, and this Bible study here today is for you. And so just by way of review, I want to quickly go over what we've covered in the Sermon on the Mount so far, because I think it would be helpful as it's been a couple weeks since we've been together. The first thing that we looked at was that we are to have the right attitude towards God, towards ourselves, and towards others. We saw that in the Beatitudes, where we're supposed to have the right attitude towards God, towards ourselves, and towards others. And then Jesus moved on and showed how we are supposed to stand out in this world as a witness for the truth. That the true child of God, the one walking in the way of the King, will be so different from the world that he'll be like salt and light in the darkness. And then he moved on to have a proper view of God's law. We're supposed to have a proper view of murder, of adultery, of marriage, of loving our enemies and loving our neighbors. And we saw that God's law, first and foremost, goes to the heart before merely the outward actions. We also saw that we are to do good works before God alone. That is, the good works you do, the nice things you do, or prayer, or fasting, or giving money. That we're not supposed to let our left hand know what our right hand is doing. And so we're supposed to do our good works for the audience of one, which is God. And then he moved on to what you guys talked about last time you were together in this sermon, which is that we are supposed to look towards the eternal reward and not be consumed by worry over temporal things. That we're not supposed to be so consumed by this life and the finances and the different things of this life, but rather we look to the next because God has promised to provide everything that we need in this life. And so we look towards heaven. And so in each of these areas, what Jesus is doing, and the reason we bring it up today, is Jesus is correcting a severe abuse and misunderstanding that had become the religious status quo of the day. Do you guys know what status quo means? Kind of means like the norm. The religious norm of the day had gotten outside of God's will and outside of God's word. And so Jesus was reeling it back in and showing them how they were truly supposed to live as citizens of God's kingdom. And now, as we come to our passage today, it's no different. That God is going to show an aspect that the Pharisees had taken out of context and really become an abuse to the people. And God is going to correct that through this study. Now, before we just jump right into our study, I want to point out something. That verse 1 in our text today, "Judge not, that you be not judged," is one of the, if not the most misquoted verses of our day. So I want to point out to you guys a very important point in interpreting your Bible. Now I want you to write down the word context, C-O-N-T-E-X-T. The context of every passage is a very important principle in understanding each and every verse in the Bible. And so what does that look like? What does context mean? Well, every verse in the Bible must be taken in its context. What that means is you need to look at the verses around it. So if you're in verse 5, don't just take verse 5 and just take that, but look at verse 4. Look at verse 6. Look at that verse in the passage that it's in. Look at the chapter that it's in. And then you go on to look at the entire book that it's in. Is it in the New Testament or the Old Testament? Is it in a gospel or is it in an Old Testament historical narrative? Is it prophecy? Is it wisdom literature like the Proverbs? You want to take each of these verses and look at the larger context. And then finally, what you do is you take that verse in light of everything the Bible has to say about that issue. And so that's what it means to take a verse in context. Now, what this will do is it will keep us safe from coming to bad conclusions and misinterpretations. And so as we come back to our verse today, many people use this verse to try to justify an ungodly or sinful lifestyle. Maybe you've heard someone do it before. They brush off or ignore the reality of the consequences of their sin by saying something like, "Don't judge me," or "Don't judge me, bro," or "Only God can judge me." And they'll say, "It says, Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, don't judge." And so they take this verse, they separate it from all the verses around it, and they simply say, "You can't judge me for anything that I do." Now, here's my question. While we look at this verse, and especially verse 1, does Jesus really mean that those in his kingdom, the citizens of his kingdom, cannot, under any circumstances, judge whether something is wrong or right, sinful or pure, evil or virtuous, bad or good? Does this verse mean that under no circumstances you can tell somebody else that what they're doing is wrong? That's the question. Now, before we answer that question, what should we do? We should look at the... Okay, we'll edit that for the video. We'll look at the context. Very good. So the first thing we're going to do is look at the context. So let's jump into this together. Our first point is this: his command to be consistent. If you're taking notes, write that down. The first thing Jesus does is he commands them, and his command is to be consistent. Jesus here begins by making a very simple command. Now, as Jesus often does, he states a principle or a command, and then he goes on in the following verses to explain what he means by that. And so this is why it's so important we take verse 1 in its context. Look at the beginning of verse 1. This is where the command comes from. He simply says, "Judge not." Stop there for a second. That is the command. It's in the imperative form of the verb, meaning Jesus is commanding his listeners to not judge. Very simple command. And separated from the rest of the Bible, it would seem to indicate to you and I that as citizens of God's kingdom, we cannot refer to anything as bad or good. Because after all, Jesus told me not to judge, right? And so if you take that by itself out of its context, that's what it seems to mean. The word judge, it means to decide. It means to condemn. It means to conclude or to sentence. It's like a judge hearing the evidence and coming to the conclusion, smacking the gavel and giving the sentence. Basically, it means to come to a conclusion based on what you know or see. Now, here's the problem that we're really presented with. As we look at the verse and as we look at our Bibles in the New Testament especially, the problem that we're presented with is that the Bible clearly commands us to judge certain things in certain cases. You may be like, well, what do you mean? Well, the closest and easiest example is still in Matthew chapter 7. Look down at verses 15 through 16. Because Jesus is going to tell his followers to make a judgment in verses 15 and 16. So look at Matthew 7, 15 and 16. He says, "Beware of false prophets who will come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves." Look at verse 16. He says, "You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles?" Jesus says, as you watch this so-called prophet and you listen to his words and you watch his life, that you are actually supposed to come to a conclusion that he is a true prophet, someone speaking for God, or a false prophet, someone who's out there just for money or fame or whatever it may be. And so what Jesus is actually teaching them is to make a judgment. Make a judgment on what this guy, is he the real deal based on what he says and based on how he lives? That when you hear someone speak for God, you should immediately listen. What are they saying? Does it line up with God's word? And then you watch their life and you say, okay, are they actually doing what they're telling other people to do? Now, the big problem was the Pharisees were not doing that. And that's why Jesus had to warn. Is they commanded, but they did not live. And so just as a side note, this is something that all of you should be doing as well. That as someone is teaching the word of God, you should not just simply take it with blind faith, but rather you should be like the Bereans who go and search the scriptures for yourself. As you hear somebody maybe on YouTube or social media and they look really cool and they talk really cool, but I mean, that's cool for them, but is what they're saying true? How will you know? Listen to what they say. Watch their life, and you make a judgment based on that. Later in Matthew's gospel, in chapter 18, Jesus actually speaks of making a judgment against a sinning brother or sister in the Lord. That if you are sinned against by a brother or sister in Christ, that you are supposed to go to them and say, "You sinned against me and offended me. You said this, or you did this, and it offended me, and I just wanted to let you know that offended me." And so you're supposed to make a judgment. What you did was wrong and it offended me. And so first Jesus says, go and talk to them just between the two of you. And then if they don't listen, if they reject that, well, then you get the others involved. But the process in Matthew 18, it actually requires coming to a conclusion. That's what the word judge means. That someone did something wrong, that they sinned, and addressing their behavior. I think there's one more good example for you guys in Romans 13, 4. Is Jesus' command not to judge, does that mean that even the government cannot say something is right or wrong? Well, in Romans chapter 13, verse 4, we actually have God's design for government. We're not going to read it or put it on the screens, but write it down if you're interested. Romans 13, 4 tells us what God's initial design for government is, which is simply one thing: to judge between evil and good, punishing the evil and rewarding the good. Now, of course, our judgment or our government, in many cases, governments around the world have changed the definition of what is evil or good. And in that, they usurp and take away God's authority, or at least they try to. But my point is that the New Testament tells us in at least three situations that we are supposed to be judging between evil and good. And so, if Jesus does not mean that we can never exercise judgment, here's the important question. What does he mean? Because to know what it does not mean is good, but to know what it does mean is far better. And so, as we come back to our text, we see that this principle, like much of the rest of the sermon, Jesus is correcting the religious abuse of his day. The Pharisees were harsh, legalistic, fault-finding hypocrites who unfairly judged the people. This harsh, legalistic, fault-finding, hypocritical judgment is what Jesus is prohibiting here. That is what Jesus is speaking against. And to find that out, let's look at the verse in context. Look at all of verse 1 with me. He says, "Judge not, that you not be judged." He gives us a reason for not judging harshly or unfairly. Why should we not judge harshly and unfairly? Well, because he says, "You yourself will be judged." Now, this is true in the negative. Listen carefully. It's true in the negative. Do not judge so that you will not be judged. You guys hear the two negatives? Not and not? Well, it's actually also true in the positive. If I judge someone else, I too will be judged. And we see that as we look at the next verse. Look at verse 2. Jesus says, "For with whatever judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." And so Jesus clearly states here that however I judge someone else, I will be judged myself. Now, this has good application for you and I, even here and now. It also has application for eternity, which we'll get to, but it has application here and now. Maybe some of you guys are older or younger siblings, and your sibling does something wrong, or maybe you're the one that does something wrong, and you go to them, and you're very harsh, you're very sharp, you're very rude, and you condemn them in their behavior, okay? And you make them feel horrible about themselves, and then you move on. How do you think they're going to treat you when you accidentally do something wrong? The same way, right? And that's exactly what Jesus says. He says there, "With the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." Well, that word "measure" is the Greek word from where we get the word meter. Do you guys know what a meter is? It's the metric standard of measurement. So a centimeter is 1/100th of a meter, whereas a kilometer is 1,000 meters. And so the meter is the standard, especially in Europe and pretty much everywhere but the U.S. We just like to be different, right? I think for good reason. Everywhere but the United States, basically the standard is the meter. So look at what Jesus is saying. He's saying when you go and judge someone else, the meter that you use, you're going to go and judge that person's sins. You get out your meter stick and you use it. That same meter stick is going to be taken over and judged against you when you sin. You want that meter stick to be pretty small, don't you? I would. If we are a harsh and unforgiving person now, we will be less likely to receive mercy from those whom we have judged harshly. Yes, in this life, that's absolutely true. But there's a much greater application. In that day we stand before God, that meter stick that we use to judge someone else's sin will be waiting for us when we get to heaven. That meter stick will be waiting there, and the way we judge other people is the way that we ourselves will be judged. Jesus spoke to this on the other end in the Beatitudes in Matthew 5:7, when he said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." Jesus said, "For those who have mercy on others will receive mercy from God." The graceless, hypocritical, self-righteous judges, the Pharisees and the scribes, are not going to receive mercy from God. Why? Because they did not give mercy out. And so those who are of the kingdom, we ought to be a very merciful people. If nothing else, because we know how much we've been forgiven of. We know when we stand before God that we've been forgiven, that God has wiped our slate clean. Nobody else knows the thoughts that have gone through your head or mine, and I don't want to know. Nobody else knows the things that you've done or said. But God knows. And with all the mercy we've received from God, we ought to be a merciful people. Jesus, actually, before he was crucified, there was a woman who came to him, and she was weeping and washing his feet and drying it with her hair, which in the first century in our culture, we'd be like, "Oh, that's really strange." But in the first century, the woman's hair was seen as her glory, and oftentimes it was only the husband that could see her hair. And so what she was doing is she was saying, "I'm giving myself to you, Jesus." But there was a Pharisee who stood by and said, "Man, if Jesus knew what kind of woman that was, he would never have let her touch him." He made a judgment. He made an unrighteous, hypocritical judgment because he himself was a sinner. And yet he judged this woman, but Jesus turned and said, Simon, let me ask you a question. If someone is forgiven of a huge debt and someone is forgiven of a little debt, which one do you think will love more? And he said, well, I suppose the one forgiven of a huge debt. He said, yeah. Well, likewise, this woman, she's loved much because she's forgiven much. So often, if we recognize how much we've been forgiven by God, it will cause us to be merciful. It will cause us to love him more so that when someone is out of line or someone sins against us, our reaction to them won't be so harsh because we know that on any given day, that could be us. And so in that, we see that we have such a bad habit and tendency to be severe and harsh with others while we overlook and minimize our own faults. We have such a bad habit to want the law to come down on someone else when they sin against us, but when we sin against someone else, that we want mercy. So often, I would assume you guys hate being lied to, right? You guys all hate being lied to? Yeah? Not all your heads nodding yes? Me too. I hate being lied to. But how often do we, when we mess up, try to change the truth just a little bit to put ourselves in a better light? No, Mom, I didn't drop 8 eggs. I dropped 4. Did you drop eggs? Yeah, only a few. You want to change it just a little bit, but a half-truth is a full lie. And just like we hate being lied to, we should also seek to avoid lying at all costs. We want ourselves to receive mercy while we want others to receive justice. I think this is most obvious while we're driving. Now, as I look around, I'm assuming only the leaders would be driving. So you guys are going to have to use your parents as your example. And hopefully you guys don't know what this is like. But I would assume if your parents are anything like me, you'll catch my drift. That while we're driving and someone cuts us off or someone gets in the wrong, they're in the wrong lane and they wait till the last second, they cross over the double white line or the double yellow line and they cut in on us and we honk or make faces. We're like, meh, you know. We make comments and we make assumptions. Oh, that person's the biggest jerk ever. They probably always do that. They wait till the last second cut in. How dare they? But then when it's us and we end up in the wrong lane and it's a total accident or we're running super late and we're like, I'm okay today because I'm late. I don't usually do this, but today I'm going to do it. Like, try to cut in at the last second. People are honking at you. You're like, well, that's rude. Let me in. Have mercy on me. But just yesterday, you were the person honking. It's so obvious so often that we want mercy for ourselves, kindness for ourselves, but justice and judgment for others. Is it a silly illustration? Absolutely. But it speaks to our sinful nature. It speaks to this desire for mercy. We see this in Romans chapter 1. In Romans chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, he says, therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge. Now that word judge is the exact same word that we have in our passage today that Jesus used. Look at what he says. You're inexcusable, whoever you are who judge, for in whatever you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you who judge practice the same things. But we know that the judgment of God is according to truth against those who practice such things. That when we point out someone else's sin and say, hey, that's wrong, what we're doing is we're recognizing and vocalizing that we know that that thing is wrong. But then when we go and do the same thing or something similar, what we've done is we've condemned ourselves because we said lying is always wrong. You shouldn't lie. But then we lie. We say stealing is always wrong. You shouldn't steal. But then you take something without permission. It's always wrong to speak evil of people behind their back, but then we say something that's not so kind behind one of our friends' backs. And so Paul says the same thing that Jesus says, that we must not take it upon ourselves to judge others while we're guilty of sin ourselves. When one does this, what they do is they place themselves under the judgment of God, because God is the true judge that in that final day will judge the secrets of men by Christ Jesus, so says the Bible. Now, this hits all of us between the eyes to some extent in one way or another. If you say none of this applies to me, I would say you're blind or deceived. Because this hits every single one of us, myself included, between the eyes in one way or another. We must take this to heart. We must examine ourselves before we seek to judge another person. This is the sort of hypocritical judgment Jesus was commanding against. This is the sort of judgment Jesus was saying, you shall not do. Now we see this again because he emphasizes in John 7, verse 24, Jesus says this. Jesus says, "Do not judge according to appearance," that is outward appearance, "but judge with righteous judgment." Jesus says, when you do have to make a judgment call, when you have to decide whether something's good or bad, evil or right or wrong, when you have to make that judgment call based in righteousness, based on the right things. We need to be very careful in our judgments. We need to recognize that before we judge anybody else, we need to examine ourselves, and we must be consistent with the judgment of ourselves. That when we get out that meter stick to judge someone else, we better make sure that we've judged ourselves by the same standard. And so the first thing is Jesus's command to be consistent. Why? Well, because whatever measure we use, the king will use back to us. Which brings us to our second point, which is this: his clarification. Now, he's going to clarify this, and this is why it's so important that we read the verse in context. He's going to clarify that we are to see clearly. You guys will understand in just a moment. Jesus here wants to be sure that they don't misunderstand, and so he applies an illustration. And quite frankly, he uses a very humorous, hypothetical, unrealistic illustration. But the reason he does this is to get his point across, okay? So look at verse 3 with me. He says, "Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye?" Jesus simply asked them, why are you so concerned about the small speck in someone else's eye when you have a massive plank in your own eye? What he's ultimately saying and what he's getting down to is that why would you concern yourself with a small fault in someone else when you ignore the much larger faults in your own life? That's what Jesus is saying. That you're so concerned about their fault while you ignore your own. The word speck, it means a speck of dust or dirt. It can mean a small piece of chaff or twig that would blow in the wind. And what it could also mean is sawdust or wood shavings. There's no doubt in my mind that as Jesus, as a carpenter, often maybe working with wood, would have gotten wood shavings in his eye or sawdust in his eye. So he knew what this was like. And if you've had something small in your eye, you know that it's quite painful and bothersome, that you could take down a big guy with a very little piece of dust when it gets in his eye. Now let me ask you a problem. Is it a problem to have something in your eye? Yes. If you can help someone else who has something in their eye, should you help them? Yeah, you should. But you should only help them if you're in the position to help them. You have no business helping someone else when you yourself are suffering from something far worse. A drowning person cannot save a drowning person. It takes someone who's not drowning to save the drowning person. And that's the thing that Jesus is communicating here. And so he says a speck, and then he compares it to a plank. You see that word plank? What it means is a beam, a beam. And what it is a piece of wood big enough to use in constructing a home or building. It's a piece of wood that's large enough to hold up the roof of a building or to be used as one of the members of the roof. And so Jesus makes a hyperbolic, exaggerated contrast for effect. Now, Luke is very helpful here. Luke puts it this way in Luke chapter 6, verse 41. Recording the same sermon, Luke says this: "Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye?" But notice what Luke says: "But do not perceive the plank in your own eye." I think this is one of the greatest problems of humanity. So often, those who are the most judgmental and harsh are the least aware of their own faults. So often, when we want to jump on someone else for something they've done wrong, we are completely oblivious to the things that we've done wrong. Oftentimes, we are oblivious to our own faults day and night. This reminds me of The Emperor's New Groove. How many of you guys have seen The Emperor's New Groove? Yeah, most of you, good. So you'll get it. For those of you who haven't seen it, There's at one point where the emperor goes to have dinner with this lady who's a witch or a spellmaker or whatever she is. And he's sitting there having dinner, and her great plan is to give him this poison that's going to kill him during the dinner so she could take over the kingdom or whatever it is that she's going to do. And so her kind of knuckleheaded assistant puts the potion in Cusco, Emperor Cusco's drink, and he drinks it and falls down what seems to be dead. And she says, great, it worked perfectly, get rid of the body. And then all of a sudden he pops back up and starts talking, and she's like, okay, that didn't go according to plan. And soon enough, he turns into a llama. This guy picked the wrong potion and turned Emperor Cusco into a llama. Now, here's the problem. Emperor Cusco did not know he was a llama. And so he goes on talking, and eventually they knock him out, put him in a bag, and put him on the outskirts of town. Well, there's this very nice, kind guy that I'd like to meet if he was real, named Pacha. You guys remember Pacha? All right, so Pacha, he's walking in on his property, and he sees this bag, and he sees something struggling in a bag. And so he opens the bag, and a llama jumps out. And so he says, oh my gosh, it's a demon-possessed llama, right? And so here's the thing. Cusco did not know he was the llama. And so he's like, a demon-possessed llama, where? And he starts running, and he falls and all that. Well, it comes to the point where Pacha tells Cusco, you are a llama. And he's like, I'm not a llama. And he goes over and he looks in the water, and in a moment he recognizes, oh, I'm a llama. Here's the thing. He was living like an emperor. Rather, he was commanding like an emperor, but he was living like a llama. I think sometimes some of us are guilty of commanding like an emperor, thinking that our life is all put together, but when all reality, we're llamas and don't even know it. We must first look at ourselves. We must first look in the mirror. We need to be sure that we examine ourselves on a regular basis as we pray, as we get into the Word, as we come to God and say, God, is there any fault in me? Is there any secret way that I need to turn from or I need to put off? God will show you in prayer that you guys should be reading the Word for yourselves on a daily basis. You shouldn't have your parents reminding you, although they should remind you, shouldn't have to. You guys should wake up in the morning and open your Bibles and say, God, would you speak to me today and get into God's Word? You know what God's gonna do? He's gonna use this Word as like a mirror that you look into. And he's gonna show you those things that are like planks in your eye. And so Jesus goes on in verse 4. He says, how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye? And look, a plank is in your own eye. Now, this interesting story that Jesus is telling takes a turn and the situation gets worse. In his illustration, this plank-eyed man tries to help his speck-eyed brother. Now, try to picture this for a moment. He has a massive home-supporting beam protruding out of his eye. And he's like, come here, let me help you get that speck. Right? I would run from that guy. I'd be like, dude, like, relax. There's a beam in your eye. Jesus plainly asks him, how's that work? Simple answer, it doesn't work. We see this vividly portrayed in John chapter 8. We're not going to go there for time's sake, but I'm going to read a little bit. In John chapter 8, the scribes and Pharisees had brought this woman who was caught in the act of adultery, and they brought her to the feet of Jesus, and they threw her down at the feet of Jesus to be stoned. You guys might remember the story. Now, here's the problem with this. They did not do this in accordance with the law of God. They only did it to find fault with Jesus. Listen carefully to these verses. So by this time, they caught the woman, they brought her, they've thrown her down at the feet of Jesus. And they said to him, teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now, Moses in the law commanded us that she should be stoned. But what do you say? Now, listen. This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, began to write in the ground with his finger as though he did not hear. One of the most famous scenes in the Bible. They come, they have stones in their hand. The woman is there. No doubt she's weeping and crying as she's ashamed and she's concerned. And Jesus just kneels down, begins to write in the sand. Continues on. So when they continued asking him, they're like, come on, teacher, what do you want us to do? Jesus raised himself up and said, he who is without sin among you, let him throw the stone first. They had no desire to honor God. They had no desire to obey his law. All they wanted to do was use this woman and her circumstances to find fault with Jesus. And so in this case, their plank was far worse than the speck of this woman. And that's why Jesus says, okay, who's ever sinless in this situation, go ahead, go first. And one by one, they each began to leave being convicted. Why? Because they had the plank in their own eye and they tried to condemn the woman with a speck in hers. And so Jesus goes on in verse 5 to call the behavior for what it is. Look at the first word of verse 5. He says, hypocrite. He said, for those who are like this, for those who judge others ignoring their own faults, they are hypocrites. This is the fourth time Jesus has used this phrase, this word in this sermon. And what Jesus is doing is he's using a word that literally means a stage actor or a two-face. The word hypocrite literally means to be a stage actor or a two-face. That you come out for scene one with one costume on, and then you go back behind the curtain and you come back out with another costume on. And in all reality, the person that you're playing is not the person that you actually are. You're being a hypocrite. And so again, we must ask, if that's what we're not supposed to do, what are we supposed to do? Well, we find that in verse 5. Look at verse 5. He says, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Jesus says here that before we worry about our brother's eye, we should take care of our own. How many of you guys have flown on an airplane before? Most of you, okay, wow, most of you guys. You guys know that when the stewardess or the flight attendant, when you begin to taxi down the runway, they come out and they make their announcement and they talk about the emergency exits, they talk about the seat belts, they talk about the different things, and then they talk about the oxygen mask. You guys know the oxygen mask that falls down? And they always say, listen, if we lose cabin air pressure, the oxygen mask will fall down. You take it, put it on yourself first, and then help the person next to you. Now me, as a father of young children, my first initial thing is, no, I'm gonna take care of my child first and then I'll worry about me. But there's actually some wisdom in this, because if the cabin loses air pressure and the oxygen level drops and you're fumbling around trying to get this mask on your kid who's probably fighting you and you pass out, who's gonna help your kid? You're gonna have to trust in someone else. But if you first put it on quickly and then go to help your kid, what you've done is make sure that your situation is taken care of, and now you've reached out to help another. You can even help the people around you. That's what Jesus is saying here. That we are to examine ourselves first before we go and try to seek to remove the speck from our brother's eye. Now, how do we examine ourselves? This is the work of God's Spirit in us. We have to be willing to allow God's Spirit to search our hearts. The psalmist put it this way in Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. The psalmist said, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. And the psalmist says this, see if there's any wicked way in me. The psalmist says, see if there's a plank in my eye, metaphorically speaking. And he says, lead me in the way everlasting. I want you to notice, look at that verse. The psalmist doesn't say, Lord, search my neighbor, know his heart, try him, know his anxieties, and tell him he's a wicked person that I don't like. No, the psalmist says, Lord, look within me and show me, reveal to me if I'm off the course, if there's anything in my life that's not pleasing to you. And we should do the same. Now, when we get to this point, you might be like, hold on a second. I'm going to make this super easy for myself. What I'm going to do is I'm not going to tell anybody when they're in sin. If they're in sin or they have a speck in their eye, I won't offer to help. Why? Because then I won't be judged. If I don't judge, I won't judge. See? Easy way out. I don't have to tell anybody. Did you guys know as believers, we're actually supposed to reach out when a brother or sister is in sin and seek to restore them? Did you guys know that those in your life, that if you know that they're headed down a dangerous path that's apart from the will of God, that you're supposed to say, hey, you're going down a dangerous path that could harm you. That as brothers and sisters in Christ, that we're supposed to be looking after each other because, like I said, so often we're blind to our own faults. And so if we're supposed to be helping one another and helping each other get specks out of our eyes, what does that look like? Well, I think it could be said this way in Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. He says, brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, listen, if someone has a speck in their eye, look at what he says. You who are spiritual, that is, you who are plankless, no plank, Restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Now, I want you to notice what Paul says. He says, examine yourself first. He says, consider yourself. Then he says, reach out to them in gentleness and love. This is the exact opposite of hypocrisy, condemnation, and pride. This is the exact opposite of what the Pharisees were doing in their day. They didn't seek to restore someone in a spirit of gentleness, but rather in their self-righteousness, they sought to condemn. And so Jesus clarifies what he means by his command, that before we seek to judge or correct someone else, we must be willing and able to see clearly ourselves. We have to make sure that there's no plank in our eye when we go to someone who has a speck in theirs. Which brings us to our third and final point, which is this: his caution. What Jesus is now going to do is he's going to give a warning. You guys ever been walking down a hallway or walking at a restaurant or a restroom and you see the caution floor wet sign? Have you ever missed that sign and slipped? I think we all have. Oh, yeah, no, yeah, you have, all right? That sign is trying to tell you there is potential danger ahead. Watch out. Walk carefully. And so in the same way, Jesus being such a good teacher, he cautions his disciples to be discerning, to be discerning. He didn't want his disciples to go out and begin judging and correcting everyone in sight. Why? The Pharisees were already doing that. That is the exact attitude Jesus is saying, don't do. Don't just go out and start correcting everybody like a legalist. We see in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, who it is that we're supposed to judge in this way. Who is it that we're supposed to look at the speck in their eye and try to help them out? Well, Paul makes it very clear. In 1 Corinthians 5:12, he says, for what have I to do with judging those who are outside, that is outside of the church, those who don't claim to be Christians? Paul says, I have no business judging them. But look at what he says next. Do you not judge those who are inside? It's the exact same word Jesus uses. We certainly should not go around trying to correct the behavior of the non-believers around us. They just won't get it. They won't understand. What they need to hear is the gospel of eternal life. But, listen carefully, when we do judge those inside the church, when we exercise this judgment that Jesus is saying, loving, patient, gentle judgment to those inside the church, it should be loving, gentle, humble. And I think this is the most important thing. Ultimately, for their spiritual benefit. That if you cannot say without the shadow of a doubt that you are doing it for their spiritual benefit, you probably should not say anything at all. Because the whole point of helping someone get the speck out of their eye is not to make them feel worse. The point of getting the speck out of their eye is to help them see clearly. And so knowing that not all will favorably respond to this sort of correction, Jesus says to be cautious and discerning. Look at our last verse, Matthew 7, verse 6. Matthew 7, verse 6, he says, do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them, that is the pearls, under their feet, turn and tear you in pieces. Dogs and swine were both despised in the first century Jewish culture, and they're still despised in many areas of the world today. They're wild, ravenous animals that scavenge for food and are violent towards people. When the New Testament talks about dogs, Jesus is not talking about Lucky that sleeps at the end of your bed at night. He's not talking about Fido that lays under your table, and when you drop a chip, you're like, oh, that's fine, Fido will get it. At least that's what I do at home. My dog takes care of it, and she appreciates that. That's not what Jesus has in mind. I once read of a missionary in Africa that was from the West, and so in his mind, dogs were loving man's best friend that would, you know, walk with you, sometimes even talk with you, protect you from other animals, and wake you up when they had to go to the bathroom. That's what he thought. But this guy, as he was walking, a few dogs appeared on the horizon, and he thought, that's interesting, there's some dogs. And as they got closer, he realized, these are not my friends. And so he began to run. He ran, and he made his way up into a tree. This pack of dogs had forced him into a tree, where he waited for 2 days for help to come. Those dogs waited at the bottom of that tree for 2 days until someone finally realized this missionary was missing and went and looked for him. Those are the kind of dogs that Jesus has in mind here. And he says, don't give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine. What does he mean by this? Well, in the first part, Jesus is speaking of the holy portion of the sacrifice. That as the people went to the temple and they offered a sacrifice for God, there was a part that they took back home to eat as fellowship and worship and thankfulness to God. And what Jesus is asking, do you take that holy portion of meat that you offered to the Lord and just give it to the wild, ravenous dogs? Now, the answer is obviously no, you don't do that. And so then he goes on to speak of a valuable pearl that was probably obtained at the risk of a diver's life because they didn't have the modern technology we have now. And again, he takes this valuable pearl and he says, is it fitting to give that to a pig? Again, the answer is no way. Not only will these animals not be appreciative of the gift, they just don't care, but they're also going to turn on you. And in this, he calls his disciples to be a discerning people. When we offer to help remove the speck from our brother's eye, we must not press the issue when they clearly do not want anything to do with our correction. When this brother or sister is clear they have no intention on hearing God's will, then you don't continue to press the issue. You let them be. You leave them into the hands of God. You don't beat them over the head with the truth, but rather you say, okay, I will be quiet about this issue. H.A. Ironside is very helpful here. He says this, it is folly to endeavor to present the deeper, more precious things of the divine revelation to men who have no desire for holiness. What Ironside is saying is it's foolish to give someone a spiritual truth, like something that's holy or something that's precious. It's foolish to give it to them when they have no desire to hear it from you. Why? Because it'll be like giving a holy piece of meat to a dog or a pearl to a pig. We need to be able to discern when a person is ready and willing to hear the value of the spiritual truth we have to share. And when it's simply giving what is holy to the dogs or casting a valuable pearl before the swine. Now, this also applies, just quickly, this also applies to when you're out sharing the gospel. That it's not your job to argue and fight someone into the kingdom of God. You can't do that. And so if you're out and maybe you're sharing with your friend or you're sharing with your classmate or a teammate on your sports team and you begin to share the gospel and they want nothing to do with it, hey, stop preaching at me. Stop talking to me. You say, okay. In which case you begin to live your life as a Christian before them and pray for them, but you're not going to force it down their throats. Why? Because eventually they're going to turn on you. And so we should be a discerning people. In Proverbs 10:17, the Bible says that he who refuses correction goes astray. And in this case, the dog or the pig or the one who at least is acting like that is the person who's refusing correction. Let me ask you a question. How do you take correction? That when your parents or when your siblings or when the junior high or high school leaders come and say, hey, you've kind of gotten off the course a little bit. You need to stop doing this. You need to go back to this. How do you take that? Do you take it humbly and say, you know what, I think you're right? Or even if you disagree, you say, okay, let me pray and think about that. Or do you turn and devour them and stomp the precious truth that they gave you under your feet? It's a truth that we must test ourselves with even today. Now, what is the ultimate goal? This is where we close. Last verse. What is the ultimate goal of all of this? Well, the ultimate goal is to turn someone who's in sin back to Christ. We see this in James 5:19-20. He says, brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth, listen, if anyone among you gets a speck in their eye and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his ways will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. James says that when you recognize that someone is off the path and you humbly, gently offer to them this valuable spiritual truth that will get the dust out of their eyes and turn them back to Christ, that what you're doing is you're turning someone from the error of their ways and saving someone from a multitude of sins. Here we see that the target that we're aiming for is turning someone back to the truth, not shaming them, not condemning them, not unrighteously judging them like the Pharisees did, but lovingly turning them back so that they don't wander yet further. We are all guilty at times of judging others more harshly than we would like to be judged ourselves. I think we'd all agree on that. Seeking justice for someone else while we want mercy for ourselves. But in the court of the king, the way of the king reigns. And what is the way of the king? That we should be consistent, that we should be clear of our own faults, that we should be discerning when it comes to exercising judgment, knowing that one day the rod or the measuring or the meter stick that we use will be used back against us by the king. In which case, we should seek to be wide in mercy and thin in justice. Let's pray together. Father, God, I am so thankful that you have not called us to perfection to get to heaven. Lord, that's not a standard that we could ever meet. And so because we are all imperfect, because we have all sinned and fallen short of your glory, God, you sent your only begotten Son into the world so that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. And now, having done that, God, you've opened our eyes to see. God, I pray for these students and I pray for myself. God, if there is any plank in our eye today, God, if there's any fault or sin that we are entirely blind to, God, that you would open our eyes, that we would come like the psalmist and say, God, show me if there's any wicked way in me. Test me, try me, know my anxieties, O Lord. Look into my heart. Open my eyes. And Lord, each of us having examined ourselves, I pray that we would be open and willing that if we see a brother or sister in Christ who's doing something that is damaging to themselves or dangerous to themselves, walking in a way that's not pleasing to you, that we would not go to our friends to talk about it, that we would not go and share it with other people, that we would seek to humbly, prayerfully, very carefully present to them that they've gotten off the path. And God, that you'd open their eyes and turn them back. Lord, each of us at different stages of our life need brothers and sisters in Christ to open our eyes to the things that we cannot see. But Lord, I don't want to be disqualified from being used by you because of a plank, an unrepentant sin in my own life. And so God, I pray for each of us that you'd open our eyes, fill our hearts full of love and compassion, and make us like Jesus Christ, as he is the one who fulfilled this command perfectly. Lord God, we're your people. Use us as you see fit. In Jesus' name, amen.